हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. आई एम डॉक्टर हीला तन्ना, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर इन द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ रोग निदान एंड विकृति विज्ञान एट द मेन कैंपस ऑफ उत्तराखंड आयुर्वेद यूनिवर्सिटी देहरादून. सो स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे विल लर्न अबाउट द डिजीज व्हिच इज बिकमिंग मोर एंड मोर प्रिवलेंट नाउ डेज. It has been kept under lifestyle disorder. Basically, it's a metabolic disorder. We are going to learn about diabetes mellitus. We'll see what are the factors due to which this disease has become more prevalent. We'll see how this disease has been defined by WHO. We'll see what are the risk factors associated with disease. We'll also see the classification of this disease, what are the clinical features presented by the patients of this disease. And again, we'll see the pathogenesis of this disease. And then we'll see the diagnostic part, that is, what are the lab parameters through which we can diagnose this disease, what are the parameters through which we can assess the severity of this disease. And what are the parameters through which we can even predict the microvascular complication of this disease. And at last, we'll discuss about the complication of this disease. So let's start. I hope all of you are ready. Be attentive and be with me. So, diabetes once upon a time was believed as a disease of opulence, but the situation has completely changed nowadays. Now this disease has lost its monopoly and it has started affecting large population of the world. This diabetes is affecting around 9.3% of the global population right now, and is expected to affect around 10.3% of population by 2030. So what are the factors which are associated with this high prevalence? So there are some important socio-economical factors like high status of life, less labor, junk frozen fried food, irregular meals, stressful jobs, and distorted lifestyle. This all together have made this disease so prevalent these days. Negligence of genetic influence adds more to improper dietary habit and lifestyle. And this improper dietary habits and lifestyle, we can find out, we can trace down from every stage of our life, right from the childhood. If we talk about the childhood, then the nurture of children has completely been changed nowadays. Working mothers have no time to prepare nutritious food for their children. Rather, this mother prefer fast food items like burger, Maggi, pizza, bread butter, etc., which are less nutritious and rich in fat and calories. Again, schools do not provide big playgrounds nowadays, and homes are converted into narrow flats. So this again diverts the attention and interest of these children in indoor games rather than energy consuming outdoor games. Moreover, botheration of homework, tuition, other classes, and hectic atmosphere of competition, this all together have made the children of this era very stressed and strained and made them prone to many stress-induced disorders, including diabetes mellitus. If we talk about the young generation, then young generation either due to laziness or due to less time, no time, they don't pay enough attention towards exercise. They remain physically inactive. Increased hours of working hours, target oriented jobs, and this altogether have made the young generation very distressful. The poor is but obviously stressed to move his life on. But the strange thing is, what you know, even the wealthy persons are not out of the catch of stress, because they are stressed to maintain their money and position. So a life of today's era is like a passenger of a train named Stress Express, which may drop him to any station like diabetes mellitus, hypertension, ischemic heart disease, IBS, etc. So if we talk about the diabetes mellitus, then it's the leading cause of morbidity and mortality all over the world. It's expected to continue as a major health problem owing to its serious complications like end-stage renal disease, IHD, gangrene of the lower extremities, blindness in adults. Let's come to the definition of this disease. As per the WHO, diabetes mellitus is defined as a heterogeneous metabolic disorder characterized by chronic hyperglycemia with disturbance of carbohydrate, fat, and protein metabolism. So it's a metabolic disorder in which there is carbohydrate, fat, and protein metabolism is disturbed, and there is a characteristic feature is chronic hyperglycemia. At this point, it's very important to discuss one more term, that is metabolic syndrome. It's also known as syndrome X. And this metabolic syndrome is a major risk factor for diabetes mellitus as well as for cardiovascular diseases. So what is metabolic disorder? Metabolic syndrome. Metabolic syndrome is a combination of central obesity, that is truncal obesity, visceral obesity, dyslipidemia, dyslipidemia in which hypertriglyceridemia and low HDL level. Here the triglyceride goes beyond 250 mg per deciliter and HDL remains less than 35 mg per deciliter. Hyperglycemia and hypertension. This all together is known as metabolic syndrome. And this metabolic syndrome or syndrome X is a major risk factor for diabetes mellitus as well as for cardiovascular diseases. Let's see the classification of this disease. The older classification was like primary and secondary type, juvenile onset diabetes and maturity onset diabetes mellitus, and insulin dependent diabetes mellitus and non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus. The previous classification was like this, but in new classification, this disease has been categorized as type 1 diabetes mellitus and type 2 diabetes mellitus. So let's see about type 1 diabetes mellitus. Type 1 diabetes mellitus constitutes about 10% cases of diabetes mellitus. It was previously termed as juvenile onset diabetes mellitus due to its occurrence in young age people. It was also known as insulin dependent diabetes mellitus because these patients have as absolute requirement of insulin replacement as a treatment. But in new classification, neither the age nor the insulin dependence are considered as absolute criteria for diagnosis. Rather, this disease has been classified as per the underlying etiology. And this type 1 diabetes mellitus is again divided into two subtypes, that is subtype 1A and subtype 1B. Subtype 1A is immune-mediated diabetes mellitus. Immune-mediated means there is autoimmune destruction of pancreatic beta cells, which leads to insulin deficiency. And subtype 1B is idiopathic diabetes mellitus, in which unknown, due to unknown reason, there will be destruction of beta cells, which will lead to insulin deficiency, and there will be tendency to develop ketosis. But these patients are negative for immune markers, whereas this type 1A, that is immune-mediated diabetes mellitus, in this type, the person will be positive for the autoimmune markers. So I hope type 1 is clear. Type 1 is divided into two subtypes, subtype 1A, subtype 1B. Subtype 1A is immune-mediated, whereas subtype 1B is idiopathic. Let's see the second type, that is type 2 diabetes mellitus, which comprises about 80% cases of diabetes mellitus. It was previously known as maturity onset diabetes or non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus. But then it was seen that this type also affects the children, adolescent, obese adolescent children. So age has not become the absolute criteria here. It can also affect the adolescent children. So this maturity onset diabetes term has become obsolete. And again, in later stages, even this type 2 diabetes mellitus patients require insulin replacement, as a treatment to prevent ketosis. So even the non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus term becomes inappropriate here. So this disease is termed as type 2 diabetes mellitus in neoclassification. The another type, very important type, is gestational diabetes mellitus. About 4% of pregnant women develop diabetes mellitus due to metabolic changes during pregnancy. Means in pregnant women, there will be metabolic changes during pregnancy, which will result into diabetes mellitus. Although these women revert back to normal glycemia after delivery, means after delivery, their blood sugar level comes to the normal. But these women are more prone to develop diabetes mellitus later in their life. So this is gestational diabetes, which occurs during pregnancy. Now, if we talk about pathogenesis of this disease, then depending upon etiology of diabetes mellitus, hyperglycemia, as we know that hyperglycemia is the main characteristic feature for diagnosis of this disease. So here hyperglycemia may result from either reduced insulin secretion or decreased glucose used by the body or increased glucose production. We'll see the pathogenesis. How it differs from its classification. So let's see the pathogenesis of type 1 diabetes mellitus. The basic phenomena in type 1 diabetes mellitus, as we know, is destruction of beta cell mass, which leads to insulin deficiency. If we talk about type 1A diabetes mellitus, then genetic susceptibility, autoimmunity, and some environmental factors become the cause for destruction of beta cells of the pancreas. And if we talk about type 1B diabetes mellitus, then we know that it's idiopathic. So no reason is known for destruction of beta cell in these cases. Now, before talking about pathogenesis of type 2 diabetes mellitus, Let me discuss the major risk factors which are associated with type 2 diabetes mellitus. So, positive family history of type 2 diabetes mellitus makes this person more prone to this disease. If the person is obese, means obesity is a major risk factor. If the person is obese, then they are also become vulnerable to this disease. Habitual physical inactivity. If patient is having sedentary lifestyle, is not physically active, then this also becomes one more reason for this disease. Previous identification of impaired fasting glucose or impaired glucose tolerance is again making the person more prone to this disease. If we talk about the female cause, then history of gestational diabetes mellitus or the delivery of baby heavier than 4 kg. These women are more prone to this disease, and females with PCOD, polycystic ovarian disorder, these females are also more prone to this disease. Again, hypertension and dyslipidemia. Dyslipidemia in which HDL level is less than 35 mg per deciliter and triglycerides are more than 250 milligram per deciliter. This is the main reason which makes the person vulnerable to this disease. And at last, history of vascular disease is also makes one person at risk to develop type 2 diabetes mellitus. So now let's see what are the factors involved in pathogenesis of type 2 diabetes mellitus. So there are three main factors which we are going to discuss in detail. The first factor is insulin resistance. Second is impaired insulin secretion. And the third factor is increased hepatic glucose synthesis. These three factors are responsible for pathogenesis of type 2 diabetes mellitus. And additionally, genetic factors as well as constitutional factors, like as we saw that obese person are more prone to this disease. Even the physically inactive persons are more prone to this disease. So let's discuss these main three factors one by one. So, first factor is insulin resistance. What is insulin resistance? Insulin resistance is the lack of responsiveness of peripheral tissues to insulin, especially of the skeletal muscle and liver. So, what happens in insulin resistance? The peripheral tissues, they become insensitive to insulin. They do not respond to insulin. So let's see how we can understand this. See, this is the normal cell, right? This red molecules are glucose molecules, and this blue molecules which you are able to see is insulin molecules. So this glucose molecules and insulin molecules are circulating in the blood. And this is the cell, and these are the insulin receptor available on cell wall. So what happens? These insulin molecules get attached to this insulin receptor, and it's only after its attachment the glucose can take entry into the cell, and this glucose can be utilized by the cell. This is the normal phenomena, right? Normal phenomena, what happens? Insulin molecules, which are secreted by the pancreatic beta cells and released into the blood, they get attached to the insulin receptor present over the peripheral tissue, cells of the peripheral tissue. And after this attachment, only the glucose can get entry into the cells and can be utilized by the cell. So, what happens in insulin resistance? In insulin resistance, these receptors, this insulin receptors become either dysfunctional or insensitive. So what will happen, though there are enough insulin molecules present in the blood, because pancreas is functioning well, and secreting insulin, and this insulin also released in the blood circulation. But what happens, since these receptors have become insensitive, they are not able to get attached to these receptors, so the glucose molecule will not get entry into the cells, they will remain unutilized, right? So which will lead to hyperglycemia. So what happens in insulin resistance, I think it should be clear. These insulin receptors become insensitive or dysfunctional. So though there is hyperglycemia or enough insulin available in the blood, but since they don't get attached to the insulin receptor, the glucose cannot get entry into the cells. So the glucose remains unutilized, and in blood you are able to see the hyperglycemia, a state of hyperglycemia, right? Shall we move further? As per the WHO, approximately 90% of the people with type 2 diabetes are either overweight or obese. So more than 90% of people with type 2 diabetes are overweight or obese. And this obesity is strongly linked to insulin resistance. This both can cause each other, but we don't know, either insulin resistance comes first or obesity comes first. Because this question is like, you know, what comes first, either hen or an egg? So, but this is for sure that insulin resistance precedes diabetes mellitus. Means before the diabetes mellitus gets manifested, you can able to see the insulin resistance condition in the patient before than the diabetes mellitus is being diagnosed. So obesity is strongly associated with insulin resistance and hence with type 2 diabetes mellitus. More than 80% patients progressing towards type 2 diabetes are insulin resistant. You can see here in this figure, 83% patients of type 2 diabetes are insulin resistant. So what will happen in this insulin resistant patients, though there is a hyperinsulinemia, the patient will still present the state of hyperglycemia. The second important factor is impaired insulin secretion. So this is also again connected to the previous factor, that is insulin resistance. So early in the course of the disease, what happens? In response to insulin resistance, there is compensatory increased secretion of insulin. What will happen? Since there is insulin resistance, the pancreatic beta cells will function more and more to produce more and more insulin. So there will be a state called hyperinsulinemia in attempt to maintain normal blood glucose level. But eventually what will happen, this beta cells of the pancreas will function more and more in the early stage, but in later stage they will become fatigued, they'll become exhausted, and then they won't be able to secrete enough amount of insulin. Although there is some secretion of insulin, so if we talk if we see the difference between type 1 diabetes mellitus and type 2 diabetes mellitus, then in cases of type 2 diabetes mellitus, there will be mild to moderate deficiency of insulin. And if we talk about type 1 diabetes mellitus, then there will be severe or absolute insulin deficiency. So I hope all of you understand that in response to insulin resistance, in the early course of disease, what will happen? The pancreatic beta cells will function more and more to secrete more and more insulin to maintain the normal glucose level. But eventually they will get fatigued, they'll get exhausted, they'll become fail to produce enough amount of insulin. So there will be insulin deficiency, which will lead to hyperglycemia. The third main factor involved in the pathogenesis of type 2 diabetes mellitus is increased hepatic glucose synthesis. So one of the normal roles played by insulin is, first is to promote hepatic storage of glucose as a glycogen, and the second is it suppresses gluconeogenesis. So if there is enough amount of insulin and it's functioning well, if there is no insulin resistance, then what are the normal function of insulin? Insulin promotes hepatic storage of glucose as a glycogen, means the excess amount of glucose will be stored as a glycogen in the liver. And the second thing it does is it suppresses gluconeogenesis, means it suppresses the production of glucose from non-carbohydrate substances like protein and lactate. But as you know, in type 2 diabetes mellitus, the main phenomena is insulin resistance by peripheral tissue. So in this peripheral tissue, the liver and skeletal muscles both are involved. So as a part of insulin resistance by peripheral tissue, the liver also shows insulin resistance. So in spite of there is a state of hyperinsulinemia in early stage of the disease, gluconeogenesis in the liver is not suppressed. Means the glucose will be produced more and more from non-carbohydrate substances. So there will be state called hyperglycemia. And again, in normal individuals, insulin will promote hepatic storage of glucose as a glycogen. But even due to insulin resistance shown by liver, there will be no hepatic storage of glucose as glycogen, which will again add to the state of hyperglycemia. So there are two conditions. If we remember the normal roles played by the insulin, we can easily understand the condition which happens during insulin resistance shown by the liver tissue. So what will happen? Insulin plays two roles. First is it promotes hepatic storage of glucose as a glycogen, and the second is it suppresses gluconeogenesis. So during insulin resistance shown by liver cells, what will happen? There will be no hepatic storage of glucose as a glycogen, means glucose will remain as it is in the blood. And the second thing is there will be no suppression of gluconeogenesis. And what will happen? This liver will start producing more and more glucose from non-carbohydrate substances. So this both phenomena will contribute into the hyperglycemia in these cases. So we saw all these three factors in detail, but both the later factors are related to first factor only. So the main phenomena occurring in type 2 diabetes mellitus is insulin resistance, and due to insulin resistance only there is decreased insulin secretion and increased hepatic glucose synthesis. Let's see, why does the beta cell fail? So as we know, to compensate for insulin resistance, beta cells of the pancreas function more and more, and there'll be over secretion of insulin. But in later stage, they'll get fatigued, they'll get exhausted, and they will become fail to produce enough amount of insulin, which will lead to beta cell dysfunction. In addition to this insulin resistance, other two processes are also responsible to cause the beta cell dysfunction. So the first is glucotoxicity, and the second is lipotoxicity. So glucotoxicity and lipotoxicity adds to the insulin resistance to cause the beta cell failure. So let's see, what is glucotoxicity? The chronic state of hyperglycemia So what we were talking about is the glucotoxicity and lipotoxicity are the additional factors with the insulin resistance, which are responsible for beta cell dysfunction. So what is glucotoxicity? The chronic state of hyperglycemia affects the beta cells negatively through the process called glucotoxicity. And this glucotoxicity is the ability of the glucose to stimulate the cell death of beta cells. Let me repeat, the chronic state of hyperglycemia negatively affects the beta cells through the process called glucotoxicity. And what is glucotoxicity? The glucotoxicity is the ability of the glucose to cause the death of, to stimulate the death of beta cells. Same is with lipotoxicity. Chronically high circulating free fatty acids again negatively affect the beta cells through the process called lipotoxicity. And what is lipotoxicity? This lipotoxicity is the ability of high circulating free fatty acids to cause the beta cell death. I hope all of you are clear. Glucotoxicity is the ability of glucose to stimulate death of beta cell, and lipotoxicity is the ability of high circulating free fatty acids to cause beta cell death or to stimulate beta cell death. So insulin resistance, glucotoxicity and lipotoxicity is all together causes beta cell dysfunction. So as a revision, three main factors, phenomena are involved in pathogenesis of type 2 diabetes mellitus. The first is increased glucose production in the liver. The second is decreased peripheral utilization by skeletal muscles. And this decreased peripheral utilization is due to insulin resistance. And the third is impaired insulin secretion. As we know that both this increased glucose production and impaired insulin secretion are mainly related to the insulin resistance. So now let's come to the clinical features part. If we talk about the clinical features of type 1 diabetes mellitus, then this disease occurs in the below age group of 35. The onset of this disease is abrupt. The patients usually presents with polyuria, polydipsia and polyphagia. These are the main three symptoms all of you have to remember. Polyuria means increased frequency of urine, polydipsia means increased thirst, and polyphagia means increased hunger. So generally the patient with type 1 diabetes mellitus presents polyuria, polydipsia and polyphagia. In these patients, there will be progressive loss of weight. They are more prone to develop metabolic complications like ketoacidosis and hypoglycemic episodes. If we talk about the clinical features of type 2 diabetes mellitus, then it usually occurs above the age of 40. The onset of this disease is slow and insidious. Generally, these patients are asymptomatic or they may present with polyuria and polydipsia. Usually, the diagnosis is made on the basis of glycosuria or hyperglycemia during physical examination. These persons are usually obese and they have unexplained weakness or loss of weight. And metabolic complications associated with disease is ketoacidosis is very infrequent in this type. So let's see the contrasting features of type 1 and type 2 diabetes mellitus. If we talk about the prevalence of this disease or frequency of this disease, then type 1 diabetes mellitus comprises 10 to 20% of the total cases, whereas type 2 diabetes mellitus constitutes 80 to 90% of the total cases. If we talk about the age at onset, then onset is early in type 1 diabetes mellitus, that is below 35 years of age. And in case of type 2 diabetes mellitus, it is late, that is after 40 years of the age. If we talk about the onset of the disease, then onset in type 1 diabetes mellitus is abrupt and severe, whereas in case of type 2 diabetes mellitus is gradual and insidious. If we talk about the HLA association, then type 1 diabetes mellitus is linked to HLA-DR3, HLA-DR4 and HLA-DQ. Whereas you won't be able to find any HLA association in cases of type 2 diabetes mellitus. If we talk about the family history, then less than 20% of the persons you'll find with the positive family history of type 1 diabetes mellitus. And in cases of type 2 diabetes mellitus, about 60% of the cases you'll find with the positive family history of diabetes mellitus. If we talk about the genetic locus, then it's unknown in cases of type 1 diabetes mellitus, whereas in type 2 diabetes mellitus, the genetic locus is chromosome 6. If we see the concordance in diabetes in identical twins, then you will find 50% concordance in type 1 diabetes mellitus and 80% concordance in type 2 diabetes mellitus. If we talk about the pathogenesis, then all of you know that in case of type 1 diabetes mellitus, either idiopathic or autoimmune destruction of diabetes mellitus or autoimmune destruction of pancreatic beta cells, whereas in cases of type 2 diabetes mellitus, all of you know that there are main three phenomena: insulin resistance, impaired insulin secretion and increased hepatic glucose synthesis. If we talk about autoimmune markers, that is islet cell antibodies, then these autoimmune markers are present in cases of type 1 diabetes mellitus because there is autoimmune phenomena, and these markers are negative in cases of type 2 diabetes mellitus because there is no autoimmune phenomena involved in pathogenesis of type 2 diabetes mellitus. If we talk about the insulin level, then we all know that there is decreased insulin. There is absolute deficiency in cases of type 1 diabetes mellitus. So you will find the decreased insulin level in type 1 diabetes mellitus patients. Whereas if you talk about type 2 diabetes mellitus, then all of you know that either in cases of type 2 diabetes mellitus, either the insulin level will be normal or you will find the state of hyperinsulinemia. Because due to insulin resistance, the beta cells of the pancreas function more and more to secrete more and more insulin. So you will find either normal insulin level or hyperinsulinemia, means increased insulin level. But mind well, in later stage, you can also find insulin deficiency in cases of type 2 diabetes mellitus. Again, if we talk about the amyloidosis, then it's very infrequent in type 1 diabetes mellitus and very common in chronic cases of type 2 diabetes mellitus. If we talk about the acute complications, then ketoacidosis and hypoglycemic episodes are the acute complications associated with type 1 diabetes mellitus, whereas hyperosmolar coma is related to type 2 diabetes mellitus. Now let's come a very important part of this lecture, that is diagnosis of this disease. Means what are the lab parameters through which we can diagnose this disease. If we talk about these parameters, then some of these parameters are related to diagnosis of this disease. Some are responsible or related to assess the severity of the disease, and some are necessary to predict the microvascular complication of this disease. So let's discuss these parameters one by one. First is blood sugar, in which we can assess the amount of glucose in the blood. Second is urine sugar, in which we can see, we detect the presence of sugar in the urine. Third is ketonuria, in which we can we detect the presence of ketone bodies in the urine. Fourth is GTT, that is glucose tolerance test. Fifth is HbA1c, that is glycosylated hemoglobin. And the next is insulin assay. So if we talk about the blood sugar, then the American Diabetes Association has given this diagnostic criteria in 2007, in which we see the fasting blood sugar, postprandial blood sugar, or random blood sugar. If we talk about the fasting blood sugar, then in this, the patients are advised to have fasting for more than 8 hours. So generally the patients are advised not to take anything after dinner. The patient is advised to have dinner before 10 p.m. on the previous day of the testing. And after that, he's advised not to take anything. And he's called for giving the sample at around 8 to 9 a.m. in the next morning. And next morning, without taking tea or breakfast. So patient should be in a fasting state. In this condition, in this state, the sample of the blood has been taken, and if this sample is assessed for the blood glucose level and this level is below the 100 milligram per deciliter, then this is normal fasting value. If it comes in between 100 and 125 milligram per deciliter, then this indicates impaired fasting glucose. And if this value comes 126 or more than 126 milligram per deciliter, then this is the confirmed case of diabetes mellitus. If we talk about the PPBS, that is postprandial blood sugar level, then in this, the patient is advised to give the blood sample just after 2 hours of the meal. If patient is not able to take meal, then alternatively, We do the 2 hours after the 75 gram oral glucose load. Means the patient is given 75 gram of glucose dissolved in 300 ml of water, and after having this, exactly at 2 hours, the blood sample is taken for assessment of blood glucose level. If this PPBS comes less than 140 milligram per deciliter, then this is normal postprandial GTT. If it comes between 140 to 199 milligram per deciliter, then it is impaired postprandial glucose tolerance. And if it comes beyond 200 milligram per deciliter, then this is the confirmed case of diabetes mellitus. And at last, we can also take sample, random sample, means any time in the day, if we take the sample and it comes beyond 200 milligram per deciliter, then this becomes the confirmed case of diabetes mellitus. So blood sugar, if fasting blood sugar level is more than or equal to 126 milligram per deciliter, then it confirms the diagnosis of diabetes mellitus. If PPBS is more than or equal to 200 milligram per deciliter and random blood sugar is more than or equal to 200 milligram per deciliter, then this it confirms the diagnosis of diabetes mellitus. And fasting blood sugar, if it's in between 100 to 125 milligram per deciliter and PPBS is between 140 to 199 milligram per deciliter, then this can be a pre-diabetic stage because here there is impaired glucose tolerance test. The second is urine testing. Urine tests are cheap and convenient, but the diagnosis of diabetes cannot be based on urine testing alone, since there may be false positive or false negatives. They can be used in population screening surveys. Urine is tested. In this, urine is tested for the presence of glucose and ketones. So, glycosuria and ketonuria, this both tests we perform in urine sample. So let's see glycosuria. So in glycosuria, we detect the presence of glucose in the urine. But the main disadvantage of relying on urinary glucose test alone is the individual variation in renal threshold. What is renal threshold? Then threshold means limit. Renal threshold means the amount of substance dissolved in the blood. If it goes beyond the certain limit, then what will happen? Kidney will start excreting it from the blood and it will be excreted, it will be passed in the urine. So if we talk about the normal renal threshold level for glucose, then it's 180 milligram per deciliter. So what will happen when the blood sugar level crosses 180 milligram per deciliter? Then the sugar will start excre then the kidney will start excreting blood sugar into the sorry, let me repeat. The normal renal threshold level for glucose is 180 milligram per deciliter. So whenever it will go beyond the renal threshold level, when it will go beyond 180 milligram per deciliter, then what will happen? The kidney will start removing this extra amount of glucose from the blood and it will be excreted through the urine. So you will be able to find the presence of glucose in the urine, which will be termed as glycosuria. So besides diabetes mellitus, glucosuria may also occur in certain other conditions like renal glycosuria, elementary glycosuria, in many metabolic disorders during starvation, and intracranial lesions like cerebral tumor, hemorrhage, head injury, etc. So we'll see two conditions which are very important. First is renal glycosuria and the second is alimentary glycosuria. If we talk about renal glycosuria, what will happen in renal glycosuria? In such cases, although the blood glucose level is below 180 mg per deciliter, but the glucose still appears regularly and consistently in the urine due to lower threshold level. So, renal glycosuria is the condition in which the glucose start appearing in the urine, start excreting in the urine even before the blood sugar level is 180 milligram per deciliter. Why such thing happen? Because in these cases, the renal threshold for glucose is reduced. So let's try to understand through this graph. This is a normal patient and this is the patient of renal glycosuria. See, here in normal individual, the renal threshold level is 180 milligram per deciliter. So after oral glucose load, if the patient is assessed for blood sugar level and glycosuria, then what will happen? If we take the sample during first half an hour, then this blood sugar level will go up to the 150 milligram per deciliter, but it's not crossing the normal renal threshold level, that is 180 milligram per deciliter. So there will be no excretion of glucose into the urine. So here, if you see the urine sample, then it will be negative for glycosuria. Even it will be negative at first hour, 1.5 hour, and at the second hour of the glucose load. So this is in case of normal individual. But if we talk about the renal glycosuria, then as we all know that in renal glycosuria, the normal renal threshold level for glucose is lowered than the normal level. So here we can see that this renal threshold level is 140 milligram per deciliter. So what happens whenever this blood sugar level crosses this renal threshold level? As we have seen that during a half an hour after the oral glucose load, it reaches to 150 milligram per deciliter. So since it has crossed one normal renal threshold level in renal glycosuria patient, so this excess amount of glucose will start excreting from the urine, from the blood into the urine. So here in this patients of renal glycosuria, you would be able to find presence of glucose into the urine during first half an hour, first hour, and even during 1.5 hour after the oral glucose load. But it comes negative during second hour of the urine sample. So this is with renal glycosuria. This is a benign condition unrelated to diabetes, and it runs in family. It may occur temporarily in pregnancy without any symptoms of diabetes mellitus. Now let's see alimentary glycosuria. Alimentary glycosuria is a rapid and transitory rise in blood glucose level above the normal renal threshold may occur in some individuals after a meal. So what will happen? Let's see through the graph only. See, in alimentary glycosuria, the renal normal renal threshold level for glucose does not change. It remains normal only. But in some patients, what happens after a meal, there will be rapid and transitory rise in the blood glucose level above the normal. So what happens? Generally, normal persons do not cross the blood glucose above the 200, above the 200 normally. But in cases of alimentary glycosuria, this person will have rapid and transitory. So this is temporary rise in the blood glucose level beyond the normal renal threshold level. So here, the patient has crossed the blood sugar level above the 200. It's around 230 here, right? So it has crossed 180 milligram per deciliter normal renal threshold level. So this person will start excreting glucose in the urine. So this person will be positive for glycosuria. But the main characteristic with this alimentary glycosuria is what you know. Since it's a transitory rapid increase in the blood sugar level, so it comes to the normal within 2 hours of taking meal. So if you take the sample at 2 hours after the meal or 2 hours after oral glucose load, then this patient will be negative for urine glucose. But if we talk about moderate diabetes mellitus cases, then these cases will never touch. There will be rise in the blood sugar level above the normal renal threshold level, but it will never come to the normal within 2 hours after the meal. So here, if you take the sample of urine at 2 hours after the meal or 2 hours after the oral glucose load, then these patients will be positive for glycosuria. So this is all about alimentary glycosuria and how you can differentiate the cases of alimentary glycosuria with cases of moderate diabetes mellitus. It's very simple, I think, you know. In alimentary glycosuria, there is temporary rise in the blood sugar and it will come to the normal within 2 hours of the meal. So if you take this urine sample just 2 hours after the meal, then it will be negative for the glycosuria. But in cases of moderate diabetes mellitus, since this patient never touches the normal renal threshold level even after 2 hours of the meal, this patient will be positive for the glycosuria if the sample is taken at 2 hours after the meal. The next test in the urine is ketonuria, in which we assess the presence of ketone bodies in the urine. This test is actually indicating the uncontrolled diabetes mellitus. So this is useful for assessing the severity of the disease and not for the diagnosis of this disease. But yes, if glycosuria and ketonuria both are present, then diagnosis of diabetes mellitus is almost certain. Besides uncontrolled diabetes, ketonuria may appear in individuals with prolonged vomiting, fasting state or called starvation, or during and exercising for long period. Now let's see the glycosylated hemoglobin. Let's see about the glycosylated hemoglobin. It's indicated as HbA1c. What is glycosylated hemoglobin? That is a minor component of hemoglobin that present in normal persons. Again, this parameter is not for diagnosis of this diabetes mellitus, but yes, it's a very good marker for assessing the efficacy of your treatment because it measures long-term glycemic control very objectively. It measures the non-enzymatic glycosylation of hemoglobin that takes place over 90 to 120 days, that is a lifespan of a red blood cell. So HbA1c therefore gives an estimate of glycemic control of previous 3 to 4 months. This assay has an advantage over traditional blood glucose test because no dietary preparation affects this measurement. See, if we talk about blood sugar level, then it's highly affected by your previous diet. If you have taken high carbohydrate diet in the previous day, then your blood sugar will show very high during the blood sugar testing. But this HbA1c, since it estimates your last 3 to 4 months, average of last 3 to 4 months estimate it gives. So this is not affected by your previous day meal at that great extent, you know. And again, this disease, testing does not require fasting. You can take random sample and measure this HbA1c value. Increased HbA1c value almost certainly means diabetes mellitus, but normal value does not rule out impaired glucose tolerance. Thus, the test is used for, this test is not used for making the diagnosis of diabetes mellitus. Moreover, since HbA1c has a direct relation between poor control and development of complication, it's also a good measure for prediction of microvascular complications. So, since it's a long-term, it measures long-term glycemic control, then if high value of this HbA1c indicates the poor control, poor glycemic control. So long-term poor glycemic control will result into the complication. So this can be a good measure for prediction of microvascular complication. K must be taken an interpretation of this HbA1c value because it varies with the assay methods used and is also affected by presence of hemoglobinopathies. As you know, this is a minor component of hemoglobin. So the HbA1c value will be greatly affected by hemoglobinopathies, anemia, reticulocytosis, transfusions, and uremia. So before interpreting the results of HbA1c, you must rule out these conditions. Lastly, insulin assay. Plasma insulin can be measured by radioimmunoassay and ELISA technique. Plasma insulin deficiency is crucial for type 1 diabetes mellitus but is not essential for making the diagnosis of diabetes mellitus. Now, at last, we'll see the complications of this disease. The acute metabolic complications include diabetic ketoacidosis, hyperosmolar hyperglycemic, non-ketotic coma, and hypoglycemia. This diabetic ketoacidosis and hypoglycemia are more related with type 1 diabetes mellitus, means these are the complications of type 1 diabetes mellitus, and hyperosmolar hyperglycemic non-ketotic coma is the main complication associated with type 2 diabetes mellitus. If we talk about late systemic complications, then diabetes affects brain, heart, kidney, eye, and neuropathy. It can also develop it can also affect neurons. So it may cause diabetic cardiomyopathy, diabetic retinopathy, diabetic nephropathy, diabetic neuropathy. It can cause diabetic foot, brain stroke, and reduced blood flow. So this is all about diabetes mellitus. We have seen what are the factors which are responsible for great prevalence, high prevalence of this disease. Then we saw the definition which has been described by WHO. Then we discussed the risk factors associated with this disease. Then we discussed the classification of this disease. There are main two types of this disease, type 1 diabetes mellitus and type 2 diabetes mellitus. Type 1 diabetes mellitus is again divided in two categories, subtype 1A and subtype 1B. Subtype 1A is immune mediated, in which there is autoimmune destruction of pancreatic beta cells, which leads to insulin deficiency. Whereas in type 1B, it's idiopathic. So there is, due to unknown reason, there will be destruction of pancreatic beta cells leading to insulin deficiency, and this patient may develop ketosis. The second type is type 2 diabetes mellitus. Then we saw the gestational diabetes mellitus. We also discussed the pathogenesis of type 1 diabetes mellitus and type 2 diabetes mellitus. In type 1 diabetes mellitus, genetic factors, autoimmunity, and some environmental factors play the role. And in type 2 diabetes mellitus, mainly three factors are involved. First is insulin resistance, second is decreased insulin secretion, and third is increased hepatic glucose synthesis. We can see that both later two factors, that is insulin decreased insulin secretion and increased hepatic glucose synthesis, are related to insulin resistance. So main phenomena which occurs in type 2 diabetes mellitus, which is responsible for pathogenesis of type 2 diabetes mellitus, is insulin resistance. So in this patient, though there is a state of hyperinsulinemia, the patient will present with hyperglycemia. Then we saw why this beta cells fail. So along with insulin resistance, more two factors are responsible. First is glucotoxicity and the second is lipotoxicity. Then we also discussed the obesity, is how this obesity is linked to insulin resistance and thus with type 2 diabetes mellitus. Then we discussed the clinical features of type 1 diabetes mellitus and type 2 diabetes mellitus. And the later part, we came to the diagnostic part and we discussed the lab parameters which are used for diagnosis as well as to assess the severity and to predict the microvascular complication of this disease. In this, we discussed blood sugar level, fasting blood sugar, postprandial blood sugar, and random blood sugar level. We also discussed about GKT. We discussed about glycosuria, ketoneuria, then glycosylated hemoglobin, and at last we discussed about insulin assay. And at last we discussed the acute complications related to type 1 and type 2 diabetes mellitus, that ketoacidosis and hypoglycemic episodes are related to type 1 diabetes mellitus, whereas hyperosmolar hyperglycemic non-ketotic coma is associated with type 2 diabetes mellitus. And in late systemic complications, the diabetes can cause diabetic cardiomyopathy, diabetic nephropathy, diabetic retinopathy, diabetic neuropathy. It may cause diabetic foot, means gangrene of lower extremities. It may cause brain stroke and reduced blood flow. So I hope all of you have grasp something from this lecture. I hope this lecture is useful for all of you all. Thank you. Thank you all. We'll meet next, maybe with the disease Prameha. So in next lecture, we'll discuss about the Prameha Vyadhi. Thank you all.